pretty broad question, and that has to do with early childhood education. Sesame Street, probably before we even used that term, early childhood education, was working toward that goal. Tell me about it. You're a pioneer.
Well, Sesame Street really, you know, emerged out of the 1960s when there was a big push to tackle poverty, I think. You know, the civil rights movement in the mid-60s, and many of us remember, you know, pretty tough times, especially in the inner cities in America, and Head Start really grew out of that as a first sort of national answer to try to give formal preschool education to millions of kids. Nothing like that ever existed before, because we knew that kids were learning. In fact, most of brain development happens before the age of five. So if you're ignoring that, it's probably a huge mistake. You can make a huge imprint and get kids prepared for kindergarten and K through 12 by doing certain things which have become pretty much standard now as accepted doctrine in America. So the whole idea really was Head Start was getting underway. There was a realization we had to have early childhood education in the US. And then there was this other realization that television was a powerful teacher. Right, it wasn't a question of what was it teaching, I mean, or whether it was teaching, it was a question of what was it teaching. It was teaching about sugared cereals, and it was teaching all the things I grew up watching on Saturday morning. So we were learning all those jingles. I can still sing the Chef Boyardee theme song from my childhood, which I will torture my kids on when they're bad. But it was really, why don't we harness that energy to teach letters and numbers and shapes and colors and basic health messages. So this was a way that our founder Joan Ganz Cooney and Lloyd Morissette, who was a foundation executive, they collaborated with this idea that you could use television to teach and create sort of a head start of the air. That was the original concept, and now we're 42 years later and have won more Emmys than any show in television history. And some of it was probably dumb luck. A lot of it was creative genius by people like Jim Henson and others, and Joan and others at the time. And I think continuous sort of reinvention have kept the thing going all these years. So it's quite a story.
But Sesame Street is one of the iconic brands in media, in television. But from what I understand, a lot of traditional educators didn't always see it that way.
Yeah, I think, you know, look, like everything else, change challenges the norm, and it's a threat to people. And for many years, including probably some today, technology has been a threat to traditional educators. I think that's really breaking down now as most of the teachers grew up sort of digital natives now, especially those entering into the teaching profession. But for many years it was kind of, there was television and informal learning, and then there was formal learning, and never the two shall meet. I think now those are really beginning to kind of be, those walls are coming down, and I think we're going to see certainly within the next decade a huge merger of technology and formal learning, because there's just too many kids in American public education, not just in Pennsylvania but throughout the whole country, who are, you know, just not getting through. They're dropping out. It's public education, for whatever reason, is not serving their interests.
Over the years, you mentioned 42 years later, over the years, has there been research as to Sesame Street's impact on the education of children?
Yeah, there has been so much research, as they say in Brooklyn, I could, you know, I could probably bury your house in research. More PhD thesis and master's thesis have been done with Sesame Street than any TV show in history. But there have been a couple very serious surveys, one done by the University of Kansas several years ago, which was a longitudinal survey, which literally tracked little kids all the way up through high school, those who were regular viewers as little kids versus those who were not. And there were marked differences, actually. I think a lot of that is just frankly building in a love of learning at a young age and having that as something that is reinforced by parents at home. And that has a lot to do with it, sort of creating a learning culture in the house. And Sesame Street has been part of that, I think, and still remains part of that for many millions of Americans.
We talked before we went on air today about someone who was talking about something they had seen years and years ago in Sesame Street and remembered that. And you seem to say, oh, I'm going to have to remember that too. That you hear those kind of stories often.
Oh, yeah. I mean, all the time. I mean, it seems that every parent certainly has a, well, every parent or child who grew up with the show has some Sesame Street story. You know, Venus Williams came on the show a couple years ago, and all she wanted to talk about was the Ladybug's picnic, you know. And sometimes you're sitting there with these celebrities and presidents, and, you know, we had Laura Bush on the show, and she actually introduced me to the head of a UN agency, and she was on there just talking about the India co-production. She knew every character from the Sesame Street India. I was like, I almost felt like, here, why don't you just take over my thing? So I think there's something about the Muppets, there's something about the innocence, I think, of Sesame Street that capture, and the humor that captures the imagination for many people. Because at the end of the day, it's fun. You know, it's kind of hard. It's a little hard to criticize. We're probably our biggest critics because we think we can always do better. But I think it's one of those things that's good about America that people can feel proud about.
Yeah, I just thought of this as you used the word criticism. And you're right. I mean, you don't hear criticism very often on Sesame Street. What happens when you do? I mean, for political reasons, for example, from time to time you'll hear a story that many people say, boy, that's out there. But Sesame Street being criticized.
Well, I think, you know, Sesame Street is an icon. And, you know, I just came back from England, actually, where I was on business. And I was reminded of the British press, who is really brutal. And they, it's really about taking down who's ever in power or who's ever in celebrity, whether it's in sports or whether it's in parliament. And I think in this country we have a little bit of that. I think it's the nature of our culture that, you know, people make it and then people try to kind of tear them down. And Sesame's not immune from that, but I don't think that those criticisms last very long. There's so much goodwill and so many positive deposits, I think, in the goodwill bank, because most people have grown up with the show. I mean, they have a relationship to Sesame Street. They have a favorite Muppet. I mean, if I walked around on the street of Harrisburg today and asked 100 people who's heard of Sesame Street, I might find one who hasn't. That's a pretty amazing thing. And if I asked who is your favorite Muppet, I'd probably get 99 answers.
A lot of states around the country, including Pennsylvania, have very tight budgets. And some governors and legislatures have had to make some very difficult decisions. Here in Pennsylvania, early childhood education, former Governor Rendell has gotten a lot of increased funding for early childhood education. What do you say when you hear that state governments are thinking about, number one, if not cutting, at least reducing?
You know, we've got a lot of studies now from people like Jim Heckman, who's the Nobel laureate at the University of Chicago, who shows investment in early childhood education has a huge payoff. We've got states in this country that are doing actuarial tables about fourth grade reading and how many prison cells they're supposed to be constructing. And we know that if you're not getting kids sort of with a love of learning and getting them prepared for kindergarten, that the chances of them then reading at a proficient level at the fourth grade and therefore succeeding in school just go way down. So this investment in early childhood is critically important. Pennsylvania has actually gone in the last 10 or 20 years from a little bit of a laggard to a huge leader through a lot of the things that are being discussed at this commission here today in Harrisburg. Business leaders coming together who sort of get it. I mean, it's a lot cheaper to invest in early childhood than it is in prisons. And I think there's a huge multiplier effect. So Pennsylvania's been pretty good. There's also, we all know that the current political climate, for better or for worse, is a lot about it being framed as protecting our children's future and future generations and not burdening them with huge debts, which I happen to agree with as well, and getting our economic house in order. There's also a piece of let's make sure that we're giving them skills. So we got to make sure that they also have the skill base to operate in the 21st century in a global world that we live in. And even just traveling in Europe last week, there's so many American companies who are just engaged in everyday commerce. And a lot of Americans just don't appreciate how interconnected our companies and our paychecks are back home. These kinds of skills have to be started at a very young age, and it's really important that states follow Pennsylvania's lead and the federal government doesn't forget about, let's not burden our kids with debt, let's also make sure that they have the skill sets to persevere.
Speaking of funding, there is a move in Congress now to defund public broadcasting. What impact would that have on children's programming?
Well, you know, it's children's programming is a really dynamic, moving world that has really changed over the last 20 years. You know, for 20 years between 1970 and 1990, there were two preschool shows in America, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood out of the great state of Pennsylvania, and Sesame Street. That was it. There was nothing else. And then the 90s came along and the cable channels really grew, who had an ability to have kind of two forms of subsidy. One was from subscription fees, the other one was from advertising, which was a dual revenue stream that could really overpower, I think, a lot of ways that public broadcasters were doing and trying to skimp together and save from corporate underwriters, government funding, and some foundation money. So you have huge, giant media companies like Viacom with Nickelodeon, Time Warner with the Cartoon Network, and the Walt Disney Company, who built these incredibly powerful kids franchises and now own a huge market share. I think the question, and they do some great programming, the big question here is, do we believe that a non-commercial service that is not about promoting goods that are marketed to children and is about promoting positive outcomes around health, around literacy, as its main focus, is something worth taxpayer subsidy? I happen to believe that it is. I think even in an environment where you've got multiple choices, and kids do have multiple choices, and Nickelodeon has some great shows, which I would encourage kids to watch, that doesn't necessarily mean that you don't want to have one place where you can go to that is a non-commercial home where a parent doesn't have to worry about their kid being marketed to, that has education first, and can connect the dots with libraries and school districts in a way that is, I think, much harder for these centralized big media companies in New York or Los Angeles or Atlanta to do, because it's about a set of local stations that probably need to do a better job, frankly, of locally connecting around educational outcomes. Public television needs to improve a lot in that arena and get refocused, I think, on education. But I think that if they can do that, there is a continued need for subsidy, and even in a budget-crunching world that we live in, that should be an important priority as kids are served up a multitude of media options that they have.
Let's look at the other side of that, though. I mean, Sesame Street, probably as a brand, would be one that, if it were to lose government funding, probably would make out pretty well in a commercial world. I mean, there probably would be companies out there, corporations out there, who would be willing to support it. But how would the show, how would the franchise change, or would it change, if that were to occur?
Well, I think you put your finger on it. I mean, the issue is not, will Sesame Street, like, drop off the face of the earth? No. And I'd be fibbing if I said that. Would it change over time? Yes. Would it change for the better? Not so sure. I think if we're a nonprofit organization and I'm paid by a board of trustees who are focused on education. We have a lot of educators on our board and we're chartered under the Board of Regents in New York State. I mean, part of that is about educational outcomes and making sure that we're putting those needs, developmental needs, first, and not about selling products. That's not what we do. We sell products through licensing agreements with for-profit companies. The way Penn State licenses football jerseys, and they make money, which, by the way, supports all the men's and women's athletic programs at Penn State. It's the same model for us. So we'll license Tickle Me Elmo. That money pays for actually the show and the research that goes into the show. I think if you ended up sort of dropping that and you had this really driven by, well, Elmo's a big hit, let's just do all Elmo all the time, that would fundamentally over time change the nature of the program, and it probably, you know, it would certainly diminish the educational impact that it's had and the ability to stay on the air so long, and as far as I can tell, continue for another 40 years. I mean, we think that there's more to do. There's a lot of programs that need to be addressed, a lot of needs to be addressed. We want to focus on those. So it's not a question of whether Sesame Street will, you know, Big Bird will fall off the face of the earth. The question is there a non-commercial service that needs to be protected to give it a home so that it can accomplish its educational mission? The other issue is other producers. And I can tell you with no uncertainty that you would lose a lot of those programs. There is really no market for programming for 6 to 9 year olds with an educational purpose. There is virtually no educational television programming for 6 to 9 year olds, which is a key time for child development in this country. That would just disappear. So we can argue whether that's worth taxpayer subsidizing. Maybe some people don't think it is. I happen to think it is. We have a show called The Electric Company that I can tell you would not, absolutely not be in production if it wasn't for a grant from the U.S. Department of Education. It just wouldn't happen.
Let's talk about that future, and let's talk about some of the things that Sesame Workshop is currently focused on. A couple issues. One, working with military families, children in military families, and two, childhood obesity.
Yes.
What are you doing in those areas? Just those two
sure.
issues.
Sure. Well, I mean, what we've tried to do really is to focus a lot of extra effort on targeted populations. So I was taking the train into work one day, and there was a front page article about a wife and two kids of a sergeant who was in Iraq who were being thrown out of their house because they were behind on their mortgage payments. And this was before the whole mortgage crisis. And I was just absolutely enraged about this, that we could be running around saying support the troops and we let this kind of thing happen. And I came into the office and said, we got to do something about this. We should have a USO show. We should be doing a... Staff said, stick to your day job, we'll figure something out. And they actually came up we did a seminar. We brought people in from the military child constituency, and we learned that there's 700,000 preschool kids of active duty military or guard and reserves in this country whose parents were being redeployed a third and fourth times. The largest deployment since World War II, not being talked about. The needs of these families not being talked about. Huge issues around mental health, stresses, traumas, comings and goings. How do you talk to your four-year-old? By the way, I'm going off to Iraq for another year. You don't know if I'm gonna come back the same, different, totally changed. So we did a show called Talk, Listen, Connect. It was a huge success, and then we covered about deployment. Then we followed that up with one about injuries, 30% of our military personnel coming back from the theater of war, either physically or so-called invisible injuries. How do you create a new normal for a daughter and her dad who's different? And then that was such a big success, we followed on with probably the toughest show we've done about grieving and what happens if dad doesn't come home at all. And we decided to make that into a broader program which can deal with everybody's got to deal with this issue. How do you tell a young child that grandma's not coming back? And so we got Katie Couric, who went through this herself with her husband passing away while her kids were toddlers or young kids. And it was a tremendous success, an amazingly fulfilling project. People can get these things through faith-based organizations, through public television stations, through our website, all for free. And this is the kind of stuff we want to continue to do. It was funded by the private sector, and it was a great project. The other one is on the childhood obesity crisis in America, which is real. We have the first generation of young kids who may not you know, have the same age expectancy as their parents. Huge outbreaks of, you know, of childhood, of heart diseases and diabetes and other maladies. So how can we use, we asked ourselves, the Sesame Street iconic characters to create a difference? And we decided, let's use Cookie Monster, of course, to learn the ultimate glutton, right? To use the cookie, to learn that cookies are a sometimes food and not an all the time food. And I was accused on Saturday Night Live of making him the Pilates monster. But other than that, you know, we love that because we know that there's a mom in Pittsburgh who can say to her little son, look, even Cookie Monster can't eat cookies all the time. And it's a way of giving parents coping skills to promote positive behaviors. So we've done a lot of work in this area. We've gotten political leaders from both sides of the aisle all over this thing who have been, some are great with the Muppets, some are not so great with the Muppets, but most, they're all into it. And we just recently did a program called Food for Thought, which is dealing with the 10 million kids in this country who are so-called food insecure, who don't have enough nutritious food to eat each day. And how do you eat healthy food on a limited budget? Do I, you know, go buy apples, or do I get a dollar meal and things like that? And these are tough questions for people. And we tried to come up with skill and coping mechanisms through a very non-threatening, positive outlook way that parents who are impacted temporarily by economic distress deal with some of these tough issues while you got little kids. That's part of our mandate, and that's what we're really proud about doing.
One final question, and it's probably the broadest question of all, but what can we expect in the future from Sesame Street and Sesame Workshop?
Well, you know, we're going to go for another 40 years, we think.
That's a prediction?
Yeah. You know, I think this whole world now of education, as we were talking before, is shifting, and I think these walls of so-called formal learning and informal learning are being torn down. And a lot of that is because the teacher corps coming into schools are digital natives themselves. So you don't have this kind of anti-technology threat that you used to have. And now I think we've got to figure out a way about how do we partner together. And the message that I always give teachers is we're on the same team. There shouldn't be a battle between your method versus our method. Our method is about helping teachers. If our Muppets and our material can help you teach and impact Jimmy in Harrisburg, that's what we want to do. And that's really what it's about. So whether it's the show that's on PBS every morning, or whether it's this outreach kit which you can get through the WIC program, or whether it's you know, trying to just provide assets for teachers to use in a classroom setting, that's how we're framing our future. It's really much more about moving to a digital education producer as opposed to a television producer. And I think this is how, in many ways, the future of education and the future of media are going to go in the country, and we're proud to be a big part of it.
Gary Knell, president of Sesame Workshop, thank you very much for being with us.
Thanks for having me.